It's good to be with you today. For those of you that cannot join us with our in-person worship this morning, just to make sure that we can give you some help as you facilitate family worship on the Lord's Day. You have the bulletin that you've been working through, hopefully, and this is the message portion of it. This is the same message that will be preached at the service today. Let me pray for us, and we'll go ahead and open up God's word. Let us pray. Lord, this is such a bizarre, strange, and a hard time in our world and in our own community, in our own even family lives, and all of the struggles that we're all facing, whether it be through employment situations or maybe even not being able to be around family again, as we see numbers spiking and as we're all trying to figure out how to live life in this hard time. And so, Lord, we thank you for this day that you have set aside in times of feast, in times of famine, in times of prosperity, in times of pandemics, Lord, that you are the anchor of our souls. You are sure and you are steady and you are the rock of our salvation, Lord. Would that stability and foundation be something that we grasp hold of this day? Holy Spirit, even as we are separated and having this word mediated through a camera and through a screen, Lord, I pray that you would work in our hearts, that we would see Jesus today, that we would see his promises and his word that is for us and that is sure. We pray these things in Jesus' strong and mighty name. Amen. Get your Bibles, go ahead, excuse me, and turn to the Gospel of Matthew. And we'll be reading two parables today, the parable of the weeds and also the parable of the net. And so go ahead and turn to Matthew chapter 13. Pick up in verse 24. Matthew 13, beginning in verse 24. This is the word of the Lord. He, Jesus, put another parable before them, saying, "The kingdom of heaven may be compared to a man who sowed good seed in his field. But while his men were sleeping, his enemy came and sowed weeds among the wheat and went away. So when the plants came up and bore grain, then the weeds appeared also. And the servants of the master of the house came and said to him, 'Master, did you not sow good seed in your field? How then does it have weeds?' And he said to them, 'An enemy has done this.' So the servant said to him, 'Then do you want us to go and gather them?' But he said, 'No, lest in gathering the weeds you root up the wheat along with them. Let both grow together until the harvest, and at harvest time I will tell the reapers, gather the weeds first and bind them in bundles to be burned, but gather the wheat into my barn.'" Skip to verse 36. "Then he left the crowds and went into the house, and his disciples came to him, saying, 'Explain to us the parable of the weeds of the field.' And he answered, 'The one who sows the good seed is the Son of Man. The field is the world, and the good seed is the sons of the kingdom. The weeds are the sons of the evil one, and the enemy who sowed them is the devil. The harvest is the end of the age, and the reapers are angels. Just as the weeds are gathered and burned with fire, so it will be at the end of the age. The Son of Man will send his angels, and they will gather out of his kingdom all causes of sin and all lawbreakers, and throw them into the fiery furnace. In that place there will be weeping and gnashing of teeth. Then the righteous will shine like the sun in the kingdom of their Father. He who has ears, let him hear." And then skip down to verse 47. "Again, the kingdom of heaven is like a net that was thrown into the sea and gathered fish of every kind. When it was full, men drew it ashore and sat down and sorted the good into containers, but threw away the bad. So it will be at the end of the age. The angels will come out and separate the evil from the righteous and throw them into the fiery furnace. In that place, there will be weeping and gnashing of teeth." It's been the reading of God's word. If you're a Christian, and I assume most of you listening are, and if you're not a Christian, I hope that this is a helpful question, a helpful place to begin as you wrestle with the claims of Christianity and with Christ. When did you realize that being a Christian didn't solve every problem you have? When did you realize that being a Christian would not solve every problem that you would have, at least not in this lifetime? Didn't make life easier when it comes to most things. And in fact, you can even pinpoint experiences, times in your life where being a Christian legitimately did make life a little bit harder. When did you realize that life isn't the way it's supposed to be, and really have that idea sink in? Because at some point, the mature believer in Jesus realizes God doesn't always take us out of the valley of the shadow of death. What God does is he goes into that valley with us. And in fact, so often it's in that valley that we realize like he's the only thing that is consistent and going with us through those dark times. And of course, in fact, Jesus, our Lord, underwent a valley of death that far surpasses any agony and horror that life extends to us, right? That the wrath of God poured out on the sinless one. But this is still a hard idea. It's still a hard word to wrestle with. Because Matthew in his gospel is saying, the king is here and he has inaugurated his kingdom, a kingdom of good news proclaimed to the poor, liberty to be proclaimed to the captives, sight recovered to the blind, liberty to those who are oppressed. That is the job description of King Jesus as described by him in the gospel of Luke. And yet look around. What good news is there for the poor, or the captive, or the blind, or the oppressed? It's like Jesus tossed the keys of like a brand new car, and we're holding the keys, and we're so excited, but after a while, we're kind of looking around, and we're wondering, is there actually a car? Or do I just have these keys? You ever asked these kinds of questions? Wrestled with these ideas? I sure have. And Jesus' closest friends did too, and this struggle, this mindset, this soul-searching, takes us to two familiar stories that Jesus told. Another parable about farming, like we looked at last week, that was the first parable about farming, the parable of the sower. And then a parable that we know would have hit close to home with many of his disciples is a parable about fishing. What are these two parables, the wheat and the weeds, and the parable of the net, what do they have to tell us, especially in light of the question I'm asking about how life can remain so difficult? Well, 3 points as we work our way through these parables. First of all, the problem Jesus is addressing. What's the problem Jesus is addressing? Secondly, we'll look at the patience Jesus is requiring. And finally, the power Jesus is concealing. First of all, the problem Jesus is addressing. Like most good stories, and Jesus was a master storyteller, you're always looking for conflict that needs to be resolved. That's the narrative arc which makes a story a story. All right, how will Romeo and Juliet be together, even though that story doesn't end so well? How will Dorothy, who is stuck in Oz, be able to come back to Kansas? How will Luke and the gang rescue Princess Leia and blow up the Death Star? Well, both of these stories that Jesus will tell, they also have problems. And you have to make sure you understand the problem to track what Jesus is teaching. The first story is about this farmer who has his farmhands, and they're doing their job. They plant some good seed, and they go to sleep. I don't think this is like a dereliction of duty. They're human beings, and so they sleep. And so presumably in the middle of the night, an enemy sneaks in, and this enemy sows weeds. He sows weeds while everyone is sleeping. And as the plants grew, it became apparent that weeds had been sown with the wheat. There's the conflict. An enemy snuck in, trying to ruin the crop. And most scholars agree that this weed that Jesus is talking about is called darnel, which is like ryegrass. And the problem is that at the beginning, it looks just like wheat. So it's not until it gets older, it's not until it sprouts an ear that you realize that you have this weed amidst the grains of wheat. It's also problematic that it's poisonous. And wheat being a food crop, that's not a good thing. And an even further problem is that the roots of the weed becomes intertwined with the wheat. And so you can't just pull the roots of the weeds out, otherwise you will get good wheat as well. And so, as Jesus helpfully explains the parable, you have to wait until the end. And you cut the stalks, and then you can separate, which is what Jesus says. Well, he interprets the parable. He says, the one who sowed the good seed is the Son of Man. The field is the world. The good seed is the sons of the kingdom. The weeds are the sons of the evil one. And the enemy who sowed the seed, that's the devil. Skip to the parable of the net, the kingdom of heaven. This time is like a net that was thrown into the sea, gathered fish of every kind. Then when it was full, men drew it ashore and sat down and sorted the good into containers, but threw away the bad. And maybe this is not the most compelling story, but it communicates Jesus' point vividly, right? Jesus is describing this large dragnet, what fishermen 2,000 years ago on the Sea of Galilee would have been using. You attach one side of the net to one boat, the other side to another boat, and you get everything in the way of that net. It takes up everything, literally everything. Good fish, bad fish, trash, garbage. You have a fishing net with good fish and bad fish, valuables and trash, all coexisting and needing to be separated. And so what problem, based on these two parables, is Jesus addressing? Okay, so Jesus is the king that we've been waiting for. He is the anointed Messiah, deliverer of Israel. He has brought in this kingdom that we have been waiting for, but we're left looking around. What about the evil? What about the sin? What about the darkness that is still all around us? Because the Messiah King that we've been waiting for has arrived, aren't we expecting all of this to be eradicated? Hasn't the new age dawned, and therefore the old age will be pushed out, but we're looking around and the old age is still all around us? You know, some other Jewish communities around the time of Jesus, they also were waiting for God's vindication of his people Israel, and so they wrote about how God would return and he would destroy the sons of darkness in order to make it a fitting place for the sons of light, right? Now, that's the story that we can buy into. That's the narrative that we can grasp hold of. This is Jesus and his magnificent 12 coming into town and getting rid of all of the enemies to make it a place that is suitable, a place that is good for us, people of light. But that's not what Jesus says. Instead, here we have the light of the world. And he says, you know, the wheat has been planted, but there are still weeds among it. He says, the kingdom is like a net that gathers fish of every kind, and when it's full, it will be taken to shore, and it will be counted, and it will be sorted, but we're not at the end of the age yet. So the net is still being filled. These parables are addressing why the kingdom of God is here, and yet, why is it that what we see with our eyes can be so distressing and depressing? That's the problem. Now, what do these parables say about its solution? And our second point we'll move to now is the patience Jesus is requiring. I'm telling you, for two familiarish parables about farming and fishing, these are really heavy because ultimately, aren't they dealing with the problem of evil? Jesus, why are there weeds? Why are there still bad fish that are mixed up with good fish after all this time? Isn't it time to head to shore so we can start separating? In the parable of the weeds, notice what the workers do. They come to the master and they say, well, now master, did you not sow good seed in your field? Then how come we have these weeds? I mean, that's the problem of evil, right? That's when we look to God and say, God, you're seeing this, right? You're seeing what's going on in our world. Are you responsible for this? You didn't do this, correct? Like, this is the new world order, Jesus, right? Your kingdom is here, and it's just, and it's righteous, and it's good. Is that correct? Then how come we have weeds? Why is there wickedness? Why does the world continue to be as broken as it is? And Jesus gives us at least a partial answer. It's only partial, but it's part of the answer as to why any weeds grow among the wheat. How and why evil grows with righteousness. It's a very simple answer, but it's a partial answer, but Jesus says it. He says an enemy has done this. And he gets more specific with the disciples when they're away from the crowds and they're back in the home. He says the good seed is not the word of the kingdom. That was the good seed last week. This week, the good seed is the sons of the kingdom. The weeds are the sons of the evil one, and the enemy, the evil sower of seed, is the devil. The Bible presents the enemy or Satan, the accuser, the devil, as a corrupter, as a spoiler, an enemy that poisons that which is good. And at least in part, Jesus explaining, that's the reason the world is the way it is. Are we comfortable with speaking of the devil and understanding this idea of the devil as Jesus is teaching it and understanding it? Are we comfortable with the idea of the devil as a personal enemy? I love what the writer Frederick Bruner, this is what he wrote. He said, a rationally denied devil rather than a Christ-conquered devil is a dangerous reality. The devil does not cease to exist because we say he ceases to exist. The Christian devil, if we may put it that way, is a devil in chains. Oh, but a denied devil is unchained fury. We see this all over the place. On a macro level, the last century, 20th century, that was supposed to be the century of progress. That is what the 19th century had been building up to. So like a snake shedding its skin, we, enlightened, evolved human beings, we could shed these old-fashioned myths of angels and devils and heaven and hell, and what we got in return was the bloodiest 100 years the world has ever known and the celebration of just new gods, new idols, totalitarianism, communism, unchecked consumerism. We got the unchained fury of this devil that we denied. See, I think we buy into Jesus' explanation because I think it's the only explanation for the evil that we actually see in the world. Because if we actually are seeing what's going on in the world, so often it has a supernatural element to it. And these are the only categories that work for describing the heinousness and the absurd evil that we see. But that's a macro level. Take it down to a micro level. Let's talk about the sinfulness of our own hearts. Have you ever experienced something like you are so resolved and committed to be patient and understanding with your spouse and with your kids, and you have all this affection for them, and you're excited to just dive in, and within 5 minutes of coming in the door, you have blown up at all of them in irritation and anger? Or maybe now you have this desire, and you found that this Bible reading plan, this kind of guided prayer study, and you're going to have these just wonderful, edifying times of study and fellowship with the Lord, and yet you experience nothing other than like a magnetic force that is pulling you away from doing those things. Now, is the sinfulness of our heart part of this? Of course it is. Of course we're culpable. Of course it's our own sinfulness. But doesn't it also feel supernatural? It feels like spiritual warfare. It feels like there is an enemy who is presently sowing evil in our own lives, presently sowing sons of evil in the world that surrounds us. And so what do we do with this evil? It feels very overwhelming. Well, this is where the parable gets hard, because Jesus' response to this evil is be patient. The workers understandably want to go out and start rooting up the weeds, but the master says no, because if you start to root up the weeds intertwined with the wheat, you are going to rip up both. You don't start sorting the fish while you're in the middle of the Sea of Galilee. You wait until you come back to shore. So Jesus presents us with a hard truth and an even harder response. Evil and sin and the sons of the evil one, they are growing in the midst of the sons of the kingdom. The Messiah is here, and therefore the sons of darkness will be eliminated. But Jesus says, not so fast with these two parables. And what is required of you and I is patience. The master refuses to impose a premature separation. Why? Because the sons of the evil one aren't the only ones growing. So are the sons of the kingdom. I mean, this is so important. Because this parable is speaking to the patience of our God. And remember, we saw this with our study of patience and the fruit of the Spirit a couple months ago. Patience always means the expansion of grace across the world. Look at all of the terrible things happening, right? And Jesus says, I know. Jesus says that I see every last ounce of evil that is happening in this world. But are you looking at the good seed as well? Are you looking at the children of the kingdom that are being planted and that are being raised up across the world? This parable isn't dark. It's not cynical. It's not discouraging, because it brings us to the heart of Jesus, because Jesus refuses the timeline of the workers because he has sinners to save in the midst of the sons of the evil one. So as Christians, we cry together, how long, O Lord? We cry out to God to return and to usher in his kingdom. Those are good prayers. Those are fitting prayers. But this parable reminds us that every unanswered prayer of Jesus returning to usher in his kingdom in full is God's merciful no, because I am planting the children of the kingdom. We are called to be patient, because we are presented with the long-suffering, gentle, patient heart of the Master. And he has not stopped calling sinners to himself. We know this because we are called to continue to patiently wait. Why is patience called for? As we've seen, it takes us to the heart of Jesus and his mission to save sinners. But patience is also called for because of the power of Jesus. And this is our final point, the power that Jesus is concealing. Present kingdom is in many ways hidden, and its chief feature appears to be weakness. That's why it's concealed. It's hidden. It's being pronounced by the king, who apparently has all the power, but he's just standing on a boat teaching them about parables and teaching disciples in a house. It appears to be weak, but it won't always be that way. Jesus doesn't say that weeds growing amidst wheat is just the way things are and will always be. He says, there is a time of harvest coming at the end of the age. And Jesus is revealing something absolutely crucial for our understanding of the New Testament. The kingdom is inaugurated, but not yet consummated. This is important. This is the New Testament's description of world history. The kingdom is breaking in now. It is a kingdom of forgiveness and salvation and liberty. But the kingdom realized in full will not come about till the end of the age. It's the already and the not yet. There's great mercy in the power of Jesus. This is the long-suffering, patient heart of God that we looked at. I love how the master says to the servants, which I think also means he's saying it to us, is he says, you and I are not capable of pulling up roots. This is the idea of Romans 12, where Paul says, repay no one evil for evil, but give thought to do what is honorable in the sight of all. Beloved, never avenge yourselves, but leave it to the wrath of God. For it is written, vengeance is mine, I will repay, says the Lord. Don't go pulling up roots now because we can't do it. It's not that it's hard, it's that it's impossible. It's not humanly possible. Remember the roots. They're intertwined. And so don't seek vengeance because you will just be addressing evil with your own evil. And there are careful distinctions to be made, and these are really important. For instance, the state has authority to temper evil, but the state that thinks that it can eliminate evil, that's a fool's errand. And any state, any authority, any government that thinks it can just eliminate evil, that becomes a very scary body. The church has a responsibility to protect the flock from evil, but remember, the authority of the church is ministerial. It's a serving authority. I think that means that we also can't pull out roots. We can't pull out roots. We can only determine insofar as we can see that a person has rejected Christ and is therefore removed from the body. But we're not eliminating evil altogether. But there is a reckoning coming. And in fact, what restrains our desire to perform our own reckonings is that there will be an end times reckoning. It's not just that justice and righteousness don't matter, it's how hard it is for us to enact them. With Jesus, there is mercy in his power. There's also justice in his power. Patience is called for, and this is probably the most remarkable part of the passage, because the authority and power resides in the one who is standing before them, telling them these parables. The kingdom is present now, but it's currently a kingdom of planting and not harvesting. But it will one day be a time of harvesting and a time of judgment. This is a message of comfort. At the very same time, it's a message of warning. God's righteous purposes will be vindicated, and evil and wickedness and sin will be no more. And again, what's remarkable is that Jesus is the one in whom all creation finds its end and purpose. The Son of Man is himself the king of this kingdom. And he takes this title, the Son of Man, that it's almost a parable in itself, right? If Jesus says, I am the Son of Man, we might respond, I too am a Son of Man. And yet this so ordinary sounding title is probably also the title that reveals Jesus' authority, because you go back to the prophet Daniel. Daniel has this vision of a greater king and a greater kingdom, one not made with hands like our kingdoms. And Daniel says, I have this vision of one like a Son of Man, and to him was given dominion and glory and a kingdom that all peoples, nations, and languages should serve him. His dominion, an everlasting dominion, which shall not pass away. His kingdom, one that shall never be destroyed. The end of the age, the harvest, the Son of Man will send his angels. And they will gather out of his kingdom all causes of sin and all lawbreakers and throw them into the fiery furnace. In the parable of the net, angels do gathering and separating of the evil and the righteous. And the same fiery furnace is mentioned with the same terrifying image of a place where there is weeping and gnashing of teeth. What do we do with these pictures, these images? What do we do with these parables? Parables of patience, but also parables of judgment. These parables contain both a warning and a promise. So first of all, heed the warning that Jesus gives us. There is a time of reckoning coming. There is a day of judgment. God's patience does not mean permission. It gives us another day to turn away from sin, to turn away from our idols, to put our trust and our hope in God, not of the things that pass away. And you see, good news, judgment is good news. When we are desperate to assign meaning to evil and desperate to assign meaning to the sin and the brokenness of our world. Otherwise, it's all just meaningless. It all just is. Judgment and hell are bizarrely uncomfortable, which I say bizarre because, and I mentioned this before, I know, but I think it's that the point stands, is that in a day and age where we cancel everyone for anything, we judge everyone we come into contact with. We go on social media to flex on our judgmentalism. Everybody is canceling everybody, but the idea of a righteous God revealing in his word this idea of judgment, it's just too much to handle. I don't want a God like that. I don't want a God like that. But these parables remind us to recognize evil, sin, and destruction for what they are, actually evil. They give us the categories for understanding the world as it is, and they give us the hope that it will not always be that way. And the warning is that our hope isn't found in us. And that has to lead us to the promise. Because the idea of judgment also has a promise. Then the righteous will shine like the sun in the kingdom of their Father. And yet if we have ears to hear that line, especially through Jesus' teaching throughout this entire section on parables, it should not confront us with a demand for moral purity. That's not the ones who are standing at the end. Instead, it should drive us to the Son of Man, Jesus. To be sown by the Son of Man is to be a recipient of grace. They use the parable of the net as an illustration, actually break down what's happening in that picture. So you have the fish, right? There is no innate goodness or badness in the different species of fish, but rather their acceptability to the fishermen. It is their acceptability, it is their beauty, in short, not found in them, but in the eye of their beholder. That's important. That's important because it speaks to the gospel. It speaks to this gift that is given. The Son of Man, right, receiving all dominion and glory and honor, as Daniel put it, brings us to the gospel where we are confronted with this kingdom that is also an upside-down kingdom, because how does Jesus receive the glory of the nations? By taking the form of a servant and being killed at the hands of those who are evil. The good news, the proclamation of the word, this word of the kingdom, is Jesus is put to death by the sons of the evil one so that there might be sons of the kingdom. And the scandal of the gospel is that those who surely look like weeds that we would just pull out, in fact, become good seeds by grace. Jesus tells us this because Jesus tells us his mission. He didn't come to save the righteous, but to save sinners. The problem Jesus addressed is the same problem we experience here and now. And you and I have the same call for patience, knowing that King Jesus has all the power and is perfectly just and wonderfully merciful. Let us pray. Lord, we thank you for your word. We pray that by your Spirit you would seal it to our hearts this day. As we are those with the questions, we are those with the problem that the disciples had, the crowds would surely scratch their heads wondering, where is the kingdom experience? Where is it seen in the kingdoms of this world that are broken, that are wicked, Lord, that allure us with their wickedness too? And yet, Lord, you call us to patience, knowing that there is a day of reckoning coming. Lord, if we have not put our trust in you, would we see that you are the only one who is perfectly righteous and good? And would you melt our hearts with your graciousness and your mercy towards sinners, toward those who are helpless? Lord, would you use your word by your Spirit to accomplish this purpose? And we pray these things in Jesus' name.